Hello guys, welcome to the channel. In this video today, we've got a very special guest, the managing director of the corporate juggernaut that is Red Bull Govan. It's the one, the only, Mark Patrick Rare. Thanks a lot for joining us, buddy. Thanks for coming on the channel. How are you? What have you been up to?
Thanks a lot for having me, mate. Appreciate it. Been good. Just all Sorare addiction still hurting from that Scotland defeat last night. A bit tender, had some beverages following that, drowning my sorrows. But yeah, all good. How you been, man?
Likewise, I was out actually quite late after the game. Went seeing some people I haven't seen in a while and all that good stuff. But I was a real kick in the stones. Like, I had some good optimism that we had the squad capable of getting the win and then going to Wales. I think it's a derby match in essence, so then anything can happen. But it was a real letdown from as soon as they scored, really. The second half goal, really, that one, as quickly as they came out second half and it was like, boom, 2-0.
Yeah, that was a killer.
I was just like, oh, Jesus, dead in the water. But so it was a real puncture in the international window for me.
I thought in the second half, Scotland dominated the game. You know, like really, like looked more dangerous. I think it was like I was saying to you just when we were chatting before. It's about the decision making, you know, and it's about those key moments where you make the right pass to play in your teammate, or you make a cross, or you know, or you shoot, or you don't shoot. You know, there was some really good advanced positions that we get into, and we just didn't pick the right pass. You know, I just maybe that's just a wee bit of lack of quality from some of the players we've got in there. But
with this international break, have you had any teams out or anything yourself, or have you been kind of knocking about the market? What have you been up to?
So kind of just playing on, you know, just buying and selling. I think, you know, like some of the goalkeepers that have been kind of coming and going have been interested in, and like the one that we talked about before, Carlos Lampe, who's signed today for Atletico, took him in, I don't know how you pronounce that properly. But in terms of actual team, I put a wee team out just in the limited. My rare team get absolutely smashed. I had we've got Victor Klaassen playing just now, but realistically, Stephen O'Donnell, DNP. That had a common card of that Georgian Marmadashvili. But he doesn't. I didn't realise he's not even playing for Georgia. So that's crashed and burned that team. But I've got a wee specialist limited team which is doing all right. I've got Marciano and goals with I'm not going to bomb at this name, but it's Chat Zidiakos, the defender from AZ for Greece. Yeah, sure. McGregor, who had McGregor was just colossal last night for
Double
Scotland.
Decisive.
Yeah. Because I thought he was going to get a block for that one that was the last man tackle, but it was an incredible tackle.
It was brilliant, man.
Manus de Boer and Pavlidis, who has been dropped for your man, Giakoumakis. So it's a bit painful, but I think he'll get on anyway. I mean, I don't...
Yeah, I think so too.
I've not seen a great deal in Northern Ireland, but you would fancy Greece to put them with the sword. You know, that should be a comfortable victory for... I mean, when you actually look at that other... The other guy that Greece have got on the bench as well, is it...
Davikis.
I mean, that's a strong bunch of young players coming through they've got.
Yeah.
Yeah, Davikis.
I had that Davikis Unlimited. Somebody in my live chat recommended him to me. I think he helped. It was a really cheap limited and I made a tiny profit on it, but I think he also helped me win like one or two tier 3 rewards or something.
Yeah.
So I've got a wee soft spot for that Davikis. I think he's been a bit patchy form-wise, but I think he's, by all accounts, a good prospect.
So you've got a team out this week, I think?
I managed to just about get a pro team out, yeah. So Robertson let me down, but I've got a big multiplier, so the 25-pointer isn't too bad. It gets rounded up to 28. and then the other four are all playing right now as we are talking. So Oblak, captain Ferran Torres, and then super rare Kostic and Gigi. So, like, anything could happen with that. I've got a couple of decisives. Could be good fun.
Well, they're 1-1-0 already.
Yeah. 32 points for Torres, but nothing to do with
it. It's already fucked up. But, Let's go 1-0 Israel.
1-0 Israel. Abada.
Abada. Bastard.
Well, was that Abada?
Yeah.
Oh. International football's kind to the Celts. Let's hope Jackie Marcus gets one as well. Did you see the Champion Edition cards?
I seen them. They look amazing. I think it's like, I mean, I know you're really bullish on those. I mean, well, we're both bullish on Celtic cards, obviously, because they're going to horse everyone next season. But, you know, those Champions cards and all the kind of special edition cards, I mean, is that just pure collector's value?
I only got, like, yeah, I think so for sure. I tried to, so I got, for the rares, I just got like backup, I didn't get anyone big really, to be honest with you, but I got like Forrest and McCarthy and Bain. And then I thought, if I'm going to have a Rogic and a Beaton, they're not a bad Rogic and Beaton to have, you know, like,
yeah,
since they played for us for 9 years, you know, they're all right.
Did you get the rares?
I got their rares, aye. So that's all the rare ones I got, those five.
Yeah.
And then I got four limiteds. I got Ralston, Abada, Hitati, which is a midfielder card.
And I seen that. That was good, actually, getting him as a midfielder card, finally, because that, yeah, that's been a good.
And then a wee Furuhashi as well to top it off.
They look good.
I think they look amazing, man. I think the limiteds look the best, but some of the rares look really nice, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
The McCarthy one as well, I don't know what you think about this, but the McCarthy one is a jersey number, if you like, a shirt number. So it's like 16 of 100, Andy's squad number 16.
That's quite a big thing for a lot of people as well, yeah. I mean, I never really twigged onto that as a thing, but yeah, see, that seems to be quite a major.
Nice coincidence, I think, in this occasion, you know, so I'll definitely.
Yeah.
When I seen that, I thought, right, I definitely need to get that one. If all the rest of them went for stupid money, and I didn't see it coming. Well, at least get a wee James McCarthy.
In time for him leaving in the summer.
I don't think he's leaving. I think he's staying.
No, he's definitely staying. There's no way he's going for that wage packet.
Nah.
I think he's sticking on to that as long as possible.
A 1,000,000%, man. But I'm starting to get to the stage now where I'm trying to gear up for, like, already. I'm trying to gear up for Europe. I've barely had much utility out of my American cards, and I'm already thinking about throwing them all, selling them all, you know. Like, some of these ones I've been building up over the last, like, year and a half or something. It's just never ending in that sense.
Why is that?
Well, I'm now getting to the point. This is actually something I was thinking about when we were going to be chatting tonight. I thought, oh, this would be something I'd like to get Mark's take on. I've kind of, like, built my... So, I've got a lot of cards in my gallery, right? And I've kind of built it around a couple of different, like, themes, if you like, to kind of keep it fun for me and just the stuff I like watching anyway. But a lot of cards that I do really like, and let's just say... Barco, right?
Yeah.
Really like the guy. But a lot of players like Barco and, like, you know, a bunch of other people, you could say, I can now buy Celtic cards. I can now get the ones I really, really want. I can basically, with the amount of teams, the amount of licenses, and with the amount of kind of firepower, if you like, the amount of collateral I've got to kind of go around the market, I'm now thinking, like, a lot of these things I've picked up and I love, and they're all really good. You know, I don't like to think I buy bad cards ever. You know, I always like to think I'm buying good players, you know. Never bought a bad player in my life, you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, of course.
You know, I'm now getting into a situation of, am I keeping a hold of this guy because I really actually want to own Barco because I'm pure, got a man crush on this guy or whatever? Or would I rather have, like, a McGregor or a Turnbull or a Kyogo or something, because I'm a big Celtic fan. I'm going to watch like 90% of Celtic's games in some fashion next year and every season for the foreseeable. And that's, like, you know, so that's the kind of dilemma I'm throwing myself into, is like, do I have some of these cards because I want them, or do I have some of these cards because I have them? Like, I've just had them for so long, you know?
I think you're totally right. I mean, like, apart from the fact that the MLS games are ordinarily on at times are difficult to watch for us because it's, what, like 2 a.m. and stuff like that, and you want to be there and watch the games. I know that you love to sit and watch, you know, have, like, you have your Saturdays and Sundays where you have your marathons, and that's a lot of fun. I guess in the coming months there's not that scale of opportunity because the season's over. So you're really looking at America and, you know, in Asia. I know that the Argentinian league back in Saturday, I think it is. That's Saturday, yeah, isn't it?
Saturday.
And then you've got the Brazilian league is running all the way through, and there's, I think the Ecuador league is back in July. Do you know the reason I know this is because there's a guy, it's Fidel Martinez, who has left Querétaro in Mexico to go to Barcelona, Ecuador.
Nice.
He actually was amazing there before. Like, he had like some crazy goal ratio with him. It was better than 1-2. And he's went back to them. He's like 32, but I think he's got the measure of that league. But I noticed, I'm experimental far more, I guess, than most people in Sorare. I have my strategy is slightly skewed. But so anyway, I bought that guy because I seen he was cheap. He was like £18 in an auction. And then suddenly I was getting bids of like £40 and I was like, something's happened here. So I went and did my homework and I found, right, he's going to them. And so I bought a bunch of limiteds of him as well because he's, I've got a good idea that he's going to do well when he goes. I think if he comes anywhere near his last spell there, he's going to be amazing. I guess to take your point, I think it's about, you know, keeping an interest. So, you know, there's a balance of keeping an interest and preparing for what is ultimately going to be a bigger interest when Celtic comes back around.
I'd be buying a lot. What I'd be thinking as well is, like, I'd probably, in terms of like selecting the cards I'd want to have, I'd probably still get like some New York cards and stuff like that. So I'd still be watching all the mad crazy stuff. But it's more like, let's see what you said there, like in terms of when you're describing your own strategy. If you could click your fingers, for example, and get like 20 ETH, would you still do that strategy? Or would you totally change it and just get the guys you exactly want and go for it? Or would you do the same thing you're doing on a bigger scale?
Yeah, on a bigger scale. I think the thing is that, like, because I regularly flip people for, you know, like 10, 20x. Like, nice. For example, I had Paul McGinn, as I know, just on a really small scale, for example, Paul McGinn. I think the Scottish football thing, I mentioned this previously in one of the pods we just recently did, is that, and it's a great vantage point for, you know, Scottish guys in the community because a lot of these players are just unknown. So they're appearing and they're just going 31-year-old guys at Hibs or whatever. And I was like, he's not that bad. Like, he's better than a pound. You know, there's a whole raft of them. There's Paul McGinn's, there's Ross McCrory is the big one I'm bullish on at the moment at Aberdeen, who's madly underpriced.
One man I know you are bullish on, news came out today, I don't know if you maybe have caught it, but Scott Allen has left Ibs.
Yeah, I seen that earlier on. I think there's a calculated risk in there, but it's factored into his general price, isn't it? And I mean, his rare cards were like a 10 on stuff like that. So, but if he goes to an SPL club, then you've won a watch with him because he can go absolutely on fire if he's in the right club.
Yeah,
but it's all about if he plays, because if he doesn't play, then he's going to waste away. But also today, Alan Forrest joined Hearts.
Yeah,
another good move. So there's lots of. It's really good for. I think I think we said it before. The SPL is grossly undervalued, and so we go for Greece there. I can see coming in.
Oh really?
I can see your eyes are getting distracted. Is it a GG? But yeah, I think that the SPL is huge value. So I would say that Baka Setis that scored it, but maybe Gigi's involved in a reassist, I don't know. It's kind of given me a new lease of life for Scottish football, because I've always been a Scottish football fan and I've always been interested, not just you know, Celtic aside, obviously a huge Celtic fan, but just Celtic aside, just a general fan of Scottish football. But this has given me like a new lease of life for that, because I have to say, for the last year, I've became addicted to, like, you know, South American and K-League and J-League. So it's good to kind of get back to my roots and, you know, and hear about that. And obviously, I've got lots of friends who support different clubs. And like, one of my good friends is a Dundee fan, and he was saying, he's a season ticket holder, and he's been like, you know, you need to watch this young player, that young player, you know. So I was, so give me the ones that specifically he's watched week in, week out, and he's saying, right, definitely need to get him. And there's two boys there, the Josh Mulligan, and it's the other, I bought him the other, these rare card the other day there, forget the boy's name, but there's two really cracking young players from Dundee that are, I think, likely to leave in that window, you know. So yeah, I think ideally I would probably buy the Celtic team, like you say, just get all my favourite players. I mean, I've got my Ada Kyogo and Idiguchi and Hatate rare cards, and I've got a whole bunch of them in limited.
Beautiful.
Maybe I should just consolidate some, because I'm probably trying to bite off more than I can chew at the moment with my gallery, you know, trying to compete in the Americas, because I can't compete. I mean, like, your Americas team is class, you know, and there's so many people in there with that have our plate stacks and stuff like that. I mean, I'm kicking about with guys like Ola Kamara, who I think is an outstanding player, right? But he's, I think that's probably the bit at the moment where I'm struggling, because my America's keepers aren't, you know, the quality that you've got. Okay, I've got Lampy. See what Lampy boy does. But
I've only got Sean Johnson and Bond for like America. Sean Johnson's pretty.
Sean Johnson's class, though, isn't he?
Bond's been a bit hot and cold.
So you need that, really. I mean, if you want to be competing for the prize spots, you need that as a fairly locked
solid
in part.
Position. Yeah, yeah, no, totally. Like, as we were talking about before, I had an Axel Werner rare as a active Champion America keeper, and then he's no active anymore.
I think, yeah, I've got Alec Kahn, who's injured at the moment. Just not found a great deal of information out, but he I think he'll come back in. I think just because the guy that's taking, you know, that's filled in is young, I think a lot of people are getting excited about that, but I think he'll go straight back in. But yeah, Can's a good keeper. I like Can. I think, but he's in Cincinnati. They're a crap team, aren't they? They're just going to get battered most of the season.
I think that wee U23 keeper that's come in is getting highly rated now as well. He's joining the Slonina club.
Yeah, I think the only thing I would say about that is, like, unlike, oh damn, there's Iceland scored. It's my clean sheet gone for Marciano. The thing I would say is that when Slonina came into Chicago, it's for Bobby Shuttleworth, Bobby Shuttleworth, I think, is a good keeper. However, it was just a fairly smooth transition from Shuttleworth to Slonina, despite him being, you know, like, so young. I think Can is probably one of the most underrated goalkeepers in that league, and I think he's been one of the best kept secrets in that league. If you go and look at what Atlanta fans are saying about Can, every one of them is gutted that he left, like, pretty much. And ironically, they now have Bobby Shuttleworth as their goalkeeper. After Brad Guzan suffered the ACL. But I think that's probably, I think I might transition out of America and just put more of my efforts into Challenger Europe, particularly because of the SPL, particularly because I know those players well, particularly because I can see there's better value there. I mean, Charlie Mulgrew, I paid £40 for. And I've spoke, Sean and I were speaking to
Scottish Pirlo.
Yeah, some of the stats boys, and they were saying, I think it's the boys analytics and some of those stats guys, Jukal James was saying that Charlie Mulgrew is pretty much in the top, you know, the top 10 in Scotland, you know, based on underlying performance. So that's the sort of guys that, okay, you're not going to, I mean, he's 36, he's not going to be around for a long time playing at that level, but if you can get another season out of him, the likes of Holt at Hearts, not at Hearts, at Livingston.
I like him, so.
These types of players that, you know, they don't have the glitz and glam of the Ajax players or whatever, but they're going to knock in big scores routinely. So who would you be looking to get? Who would be your ideal replacement?
I would just want to be greedy with Celtic cards. Like, if I was going, because the point I'm at, like, with some of the, like, to just say Barco, because that was the example I used earlier, it is kind of like, well, if I sold Barco, like, then who would I replace him with? That kind of caliber. And then, well, if I'm going to buy that kind of caliber, it's only going to be in this new kind of, like, if I was to move some stuff on and try and, like, consolidate a strategy or two, if that makes sense, then it would have to be, you know. So, I don't know. It would just be leaning more into, like, the teams that I've supported the longest. And, again, it's, like, what I always tell myself and what I always recommend to people whenever they ask me decisions on, like, actual people, like, should I buy this guy or this guy, who's better, is, like, it should always be people that, you know, no matter what, like, you should always strive to have guys that, if you joined Sorare today, if every team in the world was on it, would you still buy, like, say you've got 100 guys in your gallery, would you still buy 80 of them if you could pick anyone in the world, like, availability-wise? You know, it wasn't because, oh, they don't have this league covered, or that club's no get a, or that guy's no get a card. You know, all these things that kind of narrow you in your choice available.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
I think the thing is, as well, is I would, one thing I would encourage people to do is just watch their players, because I think of probably a lot of people that just simply, they're just staring at the SO5 scores and the last five or the last 15 and getting excited. And I think sometimes the last five in particular can be deceptive. You know, that can, it's possible for anyone to just go on a run, and, you know, the underlying performance is just, it's just been a purple patch, you know. So I would always say watch the game, go and actually look at the players that you're investing in, because you might find some of them are not so good, or you might get a wee surprise and go, wow. I mean, like, I watched that game, Ulsan. I watch a lot of the Ulsan and the K-League matches. Really like Ulsan. Crazy about the Korean striker Eom, who is now in the national team. I think he's, like, crazily underrated. He should be in, he's definitely got the talent to go to Europe for certain. But anyway, I was watching in that game, they played against Suwon, and they've obviously got the striker Lars Vellvik. Now, he, his score on Sorare for that game made it look like he, you know, he had the worst game of all time. But actually watching the match, he was extraordinary. You know, his, he was sharp. He actually had a really good goal, but it was like inches offside. But he, the composure to take it around the keeper and slot it home is fantastic. So those are the tiny margins, but a lot of people won't actually know that that's happened, and have just watched the, they've seen the results come through and go, yeah, there's another stinker for Lars. So, yeah, watch the games, particularly if you're placing gravitas on the value of some of your cards, because, you know, it's important to understand, are they going anywhere or not, you know. I mean, I seen someone the other day there, you know, in the Sorare community, they were commenting, I think just in the general football community, slagging off Ogawa, the left back at FC Tokyo, who, I've watched a lot of FC Tokyo, and I think the guy's a cracking player. Next game, he goes and scores two goals. And I was like, you know, because he was linked with Celtic as well. I mean, like half of the J League is now linked with Celtic. But he's now, I think he's signing for a team in Portugal, Ogawa. Don't know when that's happening, but I think it's a done deal. He was in the national team as well. Really good player. There's some players like that that I've, you know, just invested in terms of longer strategy where I'm thinking, I've watched that guy and he's just not like Ohashi at Shonan Bellmare, who I think is just a cracking striker and I think he's just undervalued. And I just think he's got, he just needs a wee run, you know, just to get the ball running for him. But in recent games, you know, they beat Frontale, I think it was last week, battered them 4-0. And he assisted twice in that game. So it might just be the start of that. But of course, I have been known to be wrong with some of my hunches as well. And you invest heavily in guys who you develop. As you like, you said about Barco, you have that emotional attachment because you believe in them so much, and then that can come back and bite you in the bum when you're actually maybe your sentiment is what's guiding you, as opposed to your good sound judgment. But yeah, there's,
because what I'm thinking is like see your like your left back there and like those types of guys. I've had tons of those guys in my gallery. I still do. I'm sure many people listening to this will be the same. But for me, like I've always, and like it's for the size of my gallery, for whatever it is, like I've, you know, I've kind of at every stage, it's always been about like getting my gallery to do the most it possibly could. Is getting like Ogawa, and for me it'd be like guys like Asaka and Ome Nami and Koki Machida and Chanatip and whatever.
Yeah.
Like for the last 2 years, I've been playing with these guys and other guys and whatever. Is the game playing with those guys? So then eventually you've got a gallery big enough so you can then negotiate your way into getting the, you know, the absolute cards you want. Or is that the game? And then if you're not doing that, then you're not playing. You know, that's a little bit, is it the chase is better than the catch almost, is the kind of riddle I've got knocking about my head. So is that about the chase? Is that about the catch? What is, you know, like,
you know, something I've always actually kind of wondered, what is the biggest buzz that you get from Soria? Where do you find that buzz?
Me personally?
Yeah.
100% leaderboards.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Totally. I think as well when I buy a big card, when I've bought big cards on auction, like that's been the best buzz probably, if you know what I mean, in terms of like, I can remember being like so happy, like I'm so glad, because a lot of the guys I've had that buzz with has been like Darwin, Hakimi, or you know, the big ones that I'll always have kind of held in high regard in my gallery, you know, because I've just backed them so much. I'm like, I'm so glad no one else is onto this guy as much as me, you know. And it's just that buzz, because that's on the SO5 leaderboard as well as that angle. I suppose for me, my big kick, actually thinking about it out loud with you, is like, it's that kind of bragging rights of like, I knew he was going to make it. I knew that guy was good. I called it. I seen it. I spotted that guy. I can prove it. Totally. I bought him 2 years ago, you know.
I think that's the thing. Like, I mean, I think that is, it's like, I mean, many people watch games of football and have opinions in football. But I think there's definitely, and I think it comes back to just that simple point, like, is what you're watching and understanding about the game. Because so many people can watch a full game of football and have a totally different impression of that match that you've just watched. Totally. And I think particularly, you know, the difference between, you know, like just being invested in a match to being invested in a player and a career and, you know, having a vested interest in their path, are they, you know, they're going to succeed. It's like when I seen Luis Diaz, that was one of my best ones ever, and I was like, I just went, oh my god, this guy is just insane, why is nobody else seeing this? And I was saying that for a long, long time. And then of course, it happens. But there's just, I don't know, like, I think there's just certain players you're like, nah, I don't need convinced. It's like when I seen Kieran Tierney for the first game in a Celtic shirt, I just went, nah, don't need convinced. That guy's going to be world class. And it was just, there was no first time I seen Scott Brown playing for Hibs, albeit he was playing as a right winger and he was like 17. I just went, nah, don't need to see anymore. That guy's going to go to the top. You know, there's just mannerisms and there's attributes that players have that you know, like, they've just got that. So it's good when you and I totally buy into that point that you made there, because I have that as well, where that's what I take a buzz, where I, you know, like, I'm going, yeah, I did see that, and I put my money where my mouth is, and I went and acted on it. You know, like, there's sometimes, of course, where you can go, oh, I didn't act, and that's also frustrating. Probably, yeah. In fact, the most frustrating thing where you don't act. I think probably my biggest, most frustrating one was Jota. And I kind of even knew at the time I got, like, the limited card, but I really was like, I should have just went all in on him. Definitely, but I should have just went in the full shebang that day. And I actually knew it was going to happen. I should have went in. I've got a limited for about £9 or something. But, you know, I mean, granted that, I mean, that's an amazing profit, right? But when you consider, like, I knew it was going to happen. And I just sat there and I took my takeaway was one limited card. And looking back, it is just a dumb move.
Like, you probably won't know this, right? Because, like, Jota was legit in my first 20 cards that I ever bought on Sorare. Like,
I didn't know that.
Yeah, because I didn't start out with, like, a pure big account or anything, you know? And I got him at Benfica. And do you know the main reason I bought him? It's because on his card, it says João Felipe. And everything else calls him Jota, in terms of, like, if you go on flash scores and all that. So, like, Portugal under 17s, under 19s, all those records all say Jota. And I found that for Football Index. I knew that guy was misnamed. So as soon as I came onto Sorare, I was like, I know that guy's kind of misnamed. People won't know who he is. I'll get him undervalued. Anyway, about 2 months later, he got loaned out to Real Vallecano. I was like, oh, brilliant. And I only had, like, him and, like, another guy. Maybe I had Depay. Might have just been him and Depay, and that was it. And I was like, right. And I watched, like, 4 Vallecano matches. He was on the bench for 4 games in a row. And he gradually, I can't remember the minutes, but he gradually got more minutes as the games went on. And he looked good, but he looked, honestly, it feels like when I watch him at Celtic, he's a foot taller. Because, you know, I watched him in Spain, he looked that size. He looked absolutely tiny. And he got pushed off the ball. We never get any joy. And then I was just like, oh, well. And then I couldn't really sell him for anything. And I was just, I'll just put him in the back of the gallery, forgot about him. And then one day, somebody offered me something for him. And I sold it and didn't think about it again. Until the Celtic link came. And I was like, I need to go get that Jota back. But when I seen him at Vallecano, like, so when Celtic were signing him, I was like, oh, this could be good. But I was not like, oh, this guy's going to kill it here, because I'd seen him at Vallecano like 6-8 months ago. And he did look like a boy, you know, like, looked like a little boy.
I think it was the Portugal youth games that I'd seen him. And I thought, he's got something about him, a bit of swagger.
Yeah, he definitely.
Composure. You know, I think you, and after, you know, a couple of games at Celtic, he just fitted in straight away. Just really got that temperament. There was a wee period in the middle of the season at Celtic where you thought, particularly in the Old Firm games, where you thought, is he getting a wee bit overawed here? And then he just pulled it back in. Just consistent again. Sometimes a wee bit too greedy, but it's what you're going to have to.
Comes with the territory, doesn't it?
Yeah, with players of that kind of ilk, who just, you know, they are ball players, they are going to just constantly commit defenders. Probably my only real criticism of him would be his crossing. Just think, sometimes just too many, you know, hit and hope crosses that could be worked on. But I mean, he's still learning. I think he'll eventually knock that out of them. But phenomenal player. But yeah, that was a big regret. I mean, at that day. And But I think that's like even that story you said there about watching him when he was at Vallecano. See, for me, that journey's amazing.
Well, it is now.
No, but I'm just saying in general, like that journey, see where you become like so knowledgeable about those players and you're invested in that. I mean, I'm obviously the players you like, right? You're not going to go on that journey just with every player, are you? Because I'm pretty sure there's some players you go, nah, this is the end of that the road for you and me because too many poor performances. Do you as well, like, I've got a couple of players, like, Cavallini, I've got a limited card of him, the striker at the Whitecaps. I actually think he's overperforming at the moment, is my personal belief. But he's playing in the next game week, and I fancy him to score because I mean, Salt Lake are a decent team, but I think he's just on a great run at the moment, and I fancy him to score. But I'm also hoping he scores because I just think that would be the right time to sell him because I just don't think there's much more in his tank. Is there players that you do that with as well, where you know you see, like you're thinking, right? I'm waiting for the right game for him to just blow up and then buy because I don't rate him.
I've had that exact thing like in every sense of it with one player, and that was Ayo Akinola. I don't know if you know him, but he plays for Toronto, and I got his super rare like donkeys ago. Somebody was selling a gallery, and I got two supers off him. I got Efra Alvarez and I got Akinola, and I got Barco. I got three supers, and oh mate, I paid an ETH for those three super rares, right? Back when ETH was like 1,200 quid, I got Efra Alvarez, Ayo Akinola, and Barco. And the guy wanted another ETH for super rare Tani. And I had the balance, and I tried to nickel and dime him, you know, basically. And somebody else bought the Tani, and I just got those three, and I totally regret not getting the Tani over the last year. But anyway, that's by the by. After that, like, I'd got Ayo Akinola only from like his U23, SO5. He'd scored a couple of goals and stuff like that. And, you know, like you could make a case for, oh, this guy looks like he's going to do it. Yeah. And then he came back from an injury and I watched him for, I'm going to say 10 matches or something like that. A mixture of highlights and 90 minutes, not 10, like full, like, oh, I'm going to watch Toronto tonight kind of things.
Yeah.
And as soon as, like, after about three matches, I was like, I need to sell this guy as soon as I can, like, because he's terrible. And I don't think he's barely kicked a ball since, you know, he's awful. Yeah, he's injury prone as well.
I just had a look at his stats for the season. So far, two games started out of six, 45 minutes a game. One goal.
Yeah.
For a guy that you want to be leading a team, he's certainly not. That's not the stats of...
It could become a guy who gets like 10 goals a season or something. But for me, I bought him as like a U23 hype machine. Like, oh, this guy could be big. Yeah. And then it's like, oh, crap, this guy is terrible quickly. Like, sell before.
There's a guy, he's playing for Velas Sarsfield. I actually had that, the Maxi Peroni guy. I bought him for like 60p or something in the limited card.
He's big now, isn't he?
Yeah, I sold it for like 50 quid or something. So I like, nice. Do you know what? Like, there's so many ones that I miss out on where I feel bad about it. Like, so I only did it not because it was a 50 quid. It was just like, I want to take profit more, you know, and actually maximize some of those cards. I think that boy that plays for Velas Sarsfield, Augustin Mullet, is incredible. He's I don't know what's happened to him. He's not in squads or anything. He's totally, at the beginning of the season, he was bossing it. He was getting 3-4 tackles a match. You know, huge double doubles, treble trebles all over the place. Just quality performer. And then,
boom.
Nowhere to be seen. I know some. I mean, I bought a bunch of his cards, but just purely on rating him as a player, you know, not the part of the hype machine. But yeah, that kind of went the other way, where maybe I should have just jumped at the moment where, because I think he's, I mean, you can probably get him for peanuts now, but at that point, I think he was like going for like 400. But you're right, actually, that, see that point of just understanding the U23 peak, if you can just grab that. And yeah. Okay, you might sell it too early, and you might have got a player who's going to go to the moon, and you've sold him at the bit. You're always going to run that risk anyway, but you might go the other way, like I've went with Mullet, and just totally be holding him after he's had that good sustained period, and then nothing, which is a killer. Because you don't have any utility either. But yeah, there's. I seen a few threads on Twitter. There's people talking about that, like those. I think it was maybe yourself actually was talking about like the young Argentinian players that are coming through. There's like a whole raft of them, like the younger.
Oh yeah, there's a thread I commented on. I can't remember whose thread it was, but it was an excellent thread. Whoever put it together, and I asked them about Ortega and Ferreira. Says Ortega's a dynamite player and if Celtic get him, then we're on to a winner. So let's cross our fingers and toes that that's more than a rumour.
I think.
Because again, it's similar to you, like I've done a lot of transfer, like so rare activity and like centred all around Celtic. Like, because after Jota and Kyogo, like I just picked up rares of them two. And Giakoumakis, I think there was only a super rare on the market, or the rares was so priced. I think the rare was so closely priced to the super, and I didn't have that much of a balance where I was just like, I'll just get the super and worry about a rare later. But after that, as soon as Adeguchi was rumoured, I went and got limited rare super, you know. I went and started like throwing myself into them, because like you, like you look at the Jota success and all that, you know, like winning at Celtic is big now on Sorare, you know, like in terms
what
of player
do you think
activity.
Of Adeguchi?
I think he's going to play second fiddle to O'Reilly. I think O'Reilly will be Rogic this year. He'll play 60 to 80 minutes of every game in that position. And when he comes off, it'll be Adeguchi. And when he gets rested, it'll be Adeguchi.
I've, like, from my friends involved in Celtic, some of the guys that I think you know as well, there's a lot of chat just now going around about Ange specifically going to give Adeguchi minutes and a chance in the coming season. I think, okay, we never seen much of him last season, and obviously that last day he had like 30 minutes or something like that. But I thought in that 30 minutes he was exceptional. I thought he just looked so hungry and composed, and he makes good use of the ball. He doesn't waste the ball. I think as a defensive midfielder, he could be really useful for Celtic in the European games as well. I hope he gets a chance. I don't know how we're going to line up. Is it going to be? It would give Mike, because you want McGregor playing like he was playing last night for Scotland. You don't want McGregor as a defensive midfielder. It's wasting his career in that position.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I hope Adeguchi gets features more, but I tend to agree with you. I think it's going to be more O'Reilly getting more minutes, Turnbull. I mean, you could see really O'Reilly, Turnbull and McGregor maybe Hitai. I mean, I personally would have an extreme Celtic. I would go Adeguchi, Hitai, McGregor. That would be my three. Probably very controversial for Celtic fans, but I actually think...
I think you could do that in the league. Doing that in Europe, you would need to really pick your battles with that, because McGregor and Rio are both a bit diminutive, you know?
Yeah. I think it's the thing, though, is like... when you see when you look at the link-up play with the Japanese boys, look at Kyogo and Maeda. Look at Maeda and Hitai. They link up so well. It's just nice interplay. They just have a great understanding of their game. The only other attacking player I really see that link up with is Jota and Kyogo. The rest, it just seems there's some good understanding there. I don't think, like, like Forrest and Rogic had a great link up understanding as well. You know, so there's, so I think that, you know, if it's worked on, could be really beneficial. I mean, it's not that I'm saying, I mean, Turnbull and O'Reilly are, you know, absolutely outstanding talents. My problem, and it's the same problem that I always had with Rogic, was just constant shooting from crazy positions, you know. And whilst you can get away with that if you're playing Motherwell and you're making shots in 30, 40 yards and it's 2-0 and no one really cares about it, you're playing not because, you know, obviously you're going to win the game anyway, you know, there'll be a nice slick move and you'll take 3-4 goals, or maybe that's the game, one of those shots from 40 yards goes in. But when you're playing the top European teams, they'll pick you off, and your contributions and your poor shooting and all that will be absolutely punished, as we were comfortably punished, particularly by Leverkusen. So that's why the players who are a bit more unselfish, like Ideguchi and Hitati, are far more interesting to me in that Celtic team with McGregor. Just allow McGregor to be that attacking engine like he was last night. Just say, right, you go. What is it? What do you need to be the main man here? Because I would just love to see McGregor busting forward, linking up with the likes of Jota, you know, Maeda and Kyogo, as opposed to playing B side balls in the halfway line. I mean, that's boring.
I love that as well. That'd be fucking amazing. I'm looking forward to it. But I've been kind of knocking this stuff around for like a couple of days. I'm thinking, like, you know, there'll be some more Celtic auctions. We'll get new season cards. Everyone will be there. Same with New York cards now. We've got pictures. And I say, that's the thing that just keeps bumping into my head. I'm like, what's it all about? Is it about the chase or about the catch? You know, is it about, you know, going on and trying to keep to try and win some of these guys? Or, you know, like, have I done the chase? Have I got the capital to kind of knock it around? You know, like, when you're talking about, like, some of the guys you flip around and whatever as well, like, obviously, like, taking some off the table, put some in your pocket, everyone loves doing that. That's good fun. But, like, in terms of whenever you're trying to think about upgrades or doing SO5 positions, like, surely that's the kind of purpose, is to get, you know, that's just what I keep coming back to. It's like, is it about the chases or about the catch? What do you think?
I think it's I try not to be on the fence here, but it is a bit of both. I mean, that's what I mean. Like, when you go back to when I was asking you about what do you enjoy the most about this, and you know, you were saying it's like leaderboards and, you know, and the big players. For me, it's about players I like, you know, and so there's a kind of mixture of like the players that, like the players we spoke about who you unearth, those, but then just outright players that you like, I mean, so many of the game, like you're talking about that guy, Akinola, whatever, I mean, I imagine that wasn't pleasant tuning in to watch him, because you know that it's, you know, that there's not, I mean, come on, like you tune in knowing that Dusan Tadic is in your team, or even the Celtic, I mean, when you know Kyogo's in your team and you're tuning in to watch that game, you're just rubbing your hands because you know he's going to score. but some of the guys you're tuning in and you're just like hoping and praying, you know, like, so I think that's ideally what you want to get to, is just where it's guys that you're enjoying watching. And that's not just, look, there's got to be some element of challenge in it, right? Because, you know, you could just go and pick the Liverpool team or the Bayern team or the Real Madrid team and just go, what a great job I've done. You know, like, yeah, well, that's a lot of thought you've put into that. Yeah. So there's that kind of trade-off with that type of just go straight to, you know, the gold, mm-hmm. or have a bit of fun with the challenge of it. I think it's somewhere in the middle there. I mean,
I think I'm getting a bit sentimental because, like, you again, you won't know this. I'll But like, we are recording on the 2nd of June. In 18 days, it'll be like my 2 year Sorare fucking birthday or whatever. So I'm getting all reflective and sentimental, thinking like, oh, if I could put myself back and I could say it myself in 2 years from now, you'll have the unique McGregor, you know, what would I say and all that? Starting to think all that way, the ghost of Christmas past and all that, you know. Cause it's been a wild, in a good way wild, you know, like kind of 2 years or so, basically. So I don't know if I'm just overthinking things, but that's definitely what I've been knocking around and one thing I was looking forward to batting about with you.
Do you still get pleasure of like the Americas? I guess that's one of the things I'm thinking. Do you still enjoy it?
MLS, yeah, because I watched MLS before Sorare anyway, like very passively, and it was only New York or Seattle before, whereas now like there's about five teams I'll happily watch, you know. But Argentina and Brazil, like I've enjoyed watching bits of Argentina, but like I know from watching it before from betting, it's a very slow division. It's a very slow game. There'll be not many chances at goal. There'll be a lot of fouls. Not much is going to happen in many games in Argentina. But like, there's other things going on, you know. But like, it's not a tiki taka, high tempo, you know, shots from 18 yards galore kind of league, you know.
Yeah.
So I enjoy watching it all, and I always, as I say, yeah, big buzz is always like unearthing players, and but again, like I'm putting myself into that kind of mold now, and again, I'm even thinking as we're talking now, like rares are great cards to have lots of stock in, because it's like a really powerful scarcity in terms of what it does on the platform, and it's really valuable to so many people, and it feels like the rare market is like, it is a very good market to have a lot of good cards in, is basically my point. But like, I feel like some of the cards where I'm thinking about like, oh, I spotted that guy and I really like him, maybe those guys, and I've kind of said it before, but maybe I kind of reserve that kind of stuff for like limiteds. And I'm quite excited for like the special weekly and underdogs and all that over the next couple of months, see how all they develop, and that kind of thing as well. But yeah, I'm thinking those kind of like speculation, like I've caught that guy in a Verona match and seen him come off the bench. Maybe those guys, I'd just do limiteds, and then like rares or like New York cards and Celtic cards and all that kind of fun jazz. The guy that's on loan from Man City this year or Anderlecht or whatever, you know.
I think the like one of the things that I'm doing just now is try to transition a lot of my, because I've created, I don't even know how many limited cards, like hundreds of them. I went a bit mad. But transition some of those limiteds to rare, you know, like, so just, so I guess where I'm kind of, to an extent, hedge my bets, but try to look for good value, low priced limiteds that are just about to burst. You know, the SPL we discussed obviously at the start, where I think that's a huge value opportunity at the moment, because there's just, I just think there's too many players in there who people have undervalued. And when that season starts, I think we can both agree when it comes to the middle of July, you're going to see those prices going mad. Maybe more in line with what players should be worth, but I think you've already seen it a little bit. I know like Joe Hart, for example, his card is going for crazy money now, and I think it was 2 weeks ago, it was a fraction of that.
Yeah, like I paid, and I know ETH is a totally different price, but I paid 0.6 for mine.
How much is it now?
Like I don't think any. The champion card went for like 1.2, 1.4 or something.
So yeah, there you go. It's just, you know, it's already on its way, isn't it? I think the thing is that, so yeah, I'm doing a bit of that type of, where I'm just looking for value in those guys. But ultimately, I'd like to just consolidate with, you know, that core group of guys that I just really like. And I think in my maybe the only real dilemma that I would have, I mean, saying that I've got like a bunch of America's goalkeepers, but I realistically don't have a chance in the Americas and the Challenger, Europe and the Asia for absolute certain. I've got guys that can win the competitions there, but in America's don't have consistent enough performers in terms of forward and goalkeeper. And I think those are the pretty much the two most key cards in Sorare to get properly. So maybe I just get rid of Ola Kamara. Maybe that's my bit of sentiment there as well, because he was my probably one of the best ever cards I won was in a team that Ola Kamara scored two, and actually I think he scored two and an assist. Nice. I think it was a tier one card that got me, but I was in the pro where I got about 60 position or something.
Solid.
But basically, he's kind of second choice in that team now, so I don't think I'm going to get anywhere with him. I need to maybe reinvest in something new, or just consolidate and put my best America's players into the pro, or even the weeklies probably where more of my attention is. I mean, like you said, you know, in terms of putting, you know, they're offering a good distraction during this period. I'm more excited about them than probably any of the actual, you know, the main nation leagues. You know, I think definitely the specialist is exciting. I like that element because it makes you put in two L40 players. Sorry, L15 and 40. So you've instantly got a bit of a disability there, and you're only allowed one green. So
yep. No two from the same club as well.
Exactly. So absolutely brilliant. I love that competition. I think there's a little bit more skill involved in that competition. The underdog, I prefer, do you know what? I think if it, the underdog had just stayed at 45, I would have preferred it. Because I like those kind of...
It's a goalkeeper problem, I think, with 45.
Is it that bad?
I think most like starting keepers are like 47, if they're crap. You know, like if they get any worse than that, they tend to get dropped.
Yeah.
Or, you know, 42 and stuff. So I think it's like, or whatever. I think goalkeepers was the bottleneck on that.
Was that the reason why they changed it?
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's... Sound reasoning. I think the thing is it's just
a wee bit more outfield favourable, but when it's 50, you know, because you can get some sneaky guys in with 50, you know.
I mean, the thing. I mean, if you look at, for example, in this game week, the one that we're currently in, Yaramchuk's in there. Obviously, those guys who have not been playing much with their club sides, but clearly a standout for their national team. Perfect for that sort of stuff, but yeah, I think that difference, you're totally right, from 45 to 50 is massive, because it just suddenly brings in, you know, a whole bunch of sneaky characters.
Because it's over L15, you know, like good players, how good are they over 15 games, maybe 4 games or something, you know, where they bang out 60 plus and another 10, yeah, 11, totally. 42 or whatever, you know.
I think the thing where it is powerful, particularly, is guys that have been injured or something like that and coming back and have only played, or they've just simply not played, or they've had a couple of subs appearances and then boom. With a few of them, well, that just kind of works, you know, works in my favour. But yeah, I'm probably more interested in those two tournaments than anything else. I mean, I like the idea of the new streakly thing that they've got.
Yeah.
Probably more aimed at pure newbies, I think. But it's good way to get people interested, because I think
we've got a stepping stone utility, hasn't it?
Yeah, totally. I think it just gives people an interest, a bit similar to those, you know, those free to play Sorare,
like Mega and Brag and all these things.
Yeah, so I think I like any of those ideas that just allow people to be on board with, you know, like kind of minimal investment, let them play around with it and then, you know, dip their toe in the water, and then if they're ready, then they can invest more. But, you know, I think ultimately there's you know, just more innovation like that's going to help definitely bring in a wider audience. But I definitely see that gap increasing, because I mean, guys like you, who, as you say, you were toying around with some of these top cards early doors, you know, that gap's going to increase, I reckon, this time in a year. That's going to, you know.
And that's another thing I worry about, is like, or not worry about, but when I'm thinking about this stuff, I think, well, how many of these, like, you know, in a year's time, how much more unattainable? Because it's not always for me the price of the thing. It's like, do I have the ability to get it if I want it? Like, even if I was to work hard and strive and trade and hustle and win and flip, could I realistically see myself going and getting one? Like, in a year's time, like, I think some guys will be, because now for me, I only look at, I look at any rare over an ETH, over, or maybe more than that now because of the way things have moved, over 1.2 for a rare for me, like, is too rich for my blood. You know, a super rare over, you know, 1.5, 1.8, I kind of struggle to spend money on. And like that unique McGregor I got, like, I got unique McGregor in essence, and it went on auction for 1.8 ETH, you know, and today Jota rare goes for 2.2. You know what I mean? Like, there's some opportunities that only come to that. Like, when Celtic came on, like, I was, anyway, I'm not going to bore you and everyone listening to this with the same crap I've been talking about for the last 5 months with Celtic and cards and all that. But, like, you know, it's taken, it's, yeah. So it's one of those ones where it's good. So many thinking, on you.
No, but I mean, like, the thing is that I kind of find myself in the same place, which is, you know, like, when we're doing the shows and stuff like that, you're trying to, like, I'm conscious, I'm talking about Celtic all the time, and it's like, yeah, because I really love Celtic and the players, you know, so there's, what's wrong about that? And people seem to keep listening, so, you know, it must not be that terrible. So you're, I mean, I think it's ultimately in a position where you started off in this journey where, you know, I'm pretty sure in your brain you were thinking, wouldn't it be brilliant if Celtic were on this? I'm pretty sure it was in your head quite early doors. And then, so to wait, what, like a year and a half? Well, okay, there was some players starting to gravitate towards Celtic and you're like, oh, great, I've got Gigi. Oh, great, I've got... Or oh, no, I've got a Yatty. Or a Yatty. you know, but when... I mean, that day when those Celtic players just were released, it was just really cool seeing those cards appearing on the... so, yeah, of course, like, because you've came on a journey to get there, I think that is important. You know, it's not like you just... Celtic being on the platform was the only reason that you came on. You've went through the journey because you like the platform and, you know, the... just football in general, you know, and I think that part's important. So it's totally cool, I think, that you're fixated on Celtic, and I am as well, because realistically, this is all fun just now, but my brain is thinking, it's going to be cool those European nights again, Celtic, you know, and just sitting there with the wee Sorare cards. Maybe going to the games and just like having my team ready for the game. And
mate, we'll definitely be going to Celtic matches together next season, no doubt, man. I see, I done it with John and all that in Spain, having cards and all that. And see, as well, sorry to interrupt you, right? But I had a 3-match package for Europa League this year, and I had Jota, Kyogo, you know, I had some of those guys already. And I remember I was at the Leverkusen game, and I had in my team, obviously I knew we were playing Leverkusen, but I had Wirtz in the same team as like Jota, and then I can't remember who else I had around it, but Wirtz got like 2 decisives or something at Parkhead. And I think Jota did the assist for the Kyogo goal, or was that, am I remembering that wrong? That was the home game, wasn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't remember now, I'm losing my mind, but Jota got still, decisive as well.
Yeah, Jota. So even although we lost, there was still a little...
I was kind of coming out of the stadium and like, you know what it's like at Parkhead, you don't get 4G, 3G, nothing within like a half a mile radius of the stadium most of the time on a European night. So I'm pure coming away from the stadium. Like, obviously everyone's pure like, oh, that was shite. And I'm thinking, I hope Wirtz got both those fucking decisors. And I'm fucking marching down the road, waiting for my signal to pop in, and I'm like, please be top, please be top, please be top. I don't think I bagged any good prizes that midweek, to be quite honest with you, but I think for like an hour or a couple hours, I was like 14th or something, and I was like, oh, that's a result. But yeah, it's some buzz, like, honestly, I can't wait.
Actually, I had Hincapié in that game. Oh, yeah. In a limited team, and he obviously got a massive score because he scored the goal as well, didn't he?
Yeah.
But I think it's kind of like, I mean, obviously, like, it's just an insurance policy, isn't it, in case your team gets done. I mean, I had like the Ukraine players in the wee team yesterday. I mean, nice. I've always been bullish on the Ukraine. I think I've said this quite openly before. I think they're heavily undervalued purely because the SO5 utility, obviously Shakhtar, only playing the European games. But so many of the Shakhtar players are in that Ukraine team. So you've got that added utility. But yeah, obviously I want Scotland to win, but you know, they were just there as that wee softener in the event of. But yeah, I mean realistically, that boy Florian Wirtz is just on another level, you know. So you would be daft to not to have him in there, and you know, just be that, you know,
not playing him.
Yeah, I mean, because he's quite clearly capable of smashing any team, you know, on his day. So, you know, do you any idea when he's back now, or is that?
I think it'll be after the World Cup. So I think everyone goes on winter break before the World Cup, and then I think like the last thing I heard was like he should start like making the bench before the World Cup for Leverkusen.
Yeah,
but there's no chance Germany are taking him. Like, you know, kind of idea. So you might start seeing him on team sheets before, but like that'll be at best.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. And again, he's part of the one that comes into it because he's still trading around like 2.5 ETH. And I'm looking at it like, you know, that the point of recording this is June, right? So I'm not expecting him to really play competitive football to probably February. Maybe it takes him another 2 or 3 weeks to get up to speed. Then maybe it takes him another month or two to hit his stride. And then, do you know what? It's the end of the season again.
So see, on that point, right, so you've got him, I mean, you've held him, I take it, yeah?
I won him.
So you've just kept him,
I just kept him the whole time.
He's
at level 18.
So you don't indulge in that strategy of, you know, like, just cash in when there's no utility?
I was actually really close to selling him right before the injury, because he was trading, and bearing in mind, ETH was about, it was closer to £3,000 than it was to, certainly. He was trading at the time for 3.5 ETH, and I was like, this is about time where I think Wirtz is too expensive for me to keep now.
Yeah.
And then it was injury, and then it was ETH crash. You know. But yeah, now he still goes for about 2.5, which, you know, for an injured guy, like, is incredible.
Two and a half ETH?
Aye.
It's just mad. I think it's just the age thing, isn't it? I mean,
he's so young. He's going to be playing U23 for the next 5 years or something, and he's Florian Wirtz's best, like, probably the best under-23 midfielder in the world, I'd say.
But I tend to agree with you though, like, it's that. I mean, I have to say, like, it's one part of Sorare that I think is a blind spot for the community, is age. Yeah. I think people overcompensate for young players because, like you said, I mean, that sounds great. All of that sounds great, but 5 years is a long time. I mean, who's to say that, I mean, there you go. He's already had that serious injury. You don't know what happens in 5 years.
True.
I just feel, of course, if he stays injury free, then realistically, there's every chance in the world he's going to just have that nice, clean path to the top. But I think that was a really interesting point you said there. He's got too expensive to hold on to, because that's my mentality, which is, I mean, if I got Mbappe just now, and obviously the whole community, as soon as you're near a win, they say, right, that's it. We're striving to get Mbappe. You never had Mbappe, did you? Or did you?
No, never.
No desire to get Mbappe?
Not to buy, I'd happily win him. But again, like, that was my Wirtz. You know, like, I was choking to get Wirtz. Like, because I'd seen Wirtz debut in Leverkusen, but already on Sorare, but he never got a card. And like, Wirtz was one of these guys that came out back end of a season.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean? Like, the last four games or something, and he scored. He was like the youngest guy in the Bundesliga ever to score. And I thought, oh, I'd love a Wirtz card. Didn't he have one? And then by the time it came out, like Cap was out of the bag and he was always expensive.
So if you won, let's say you won Mbappe, mm-hmm. would you keep him?
I'd probably do something similar before, like I've keep them until it's like, yeah, it's a bit too heavy now to hold on to, you know.
I think that's, see, if I won Mbappe, I couldn't justify at this stage, I couldn't justify keeping him because there's zero doubt that guy's just an absolute machine. You know, I think he'll, his hundreds pretty much every week. Yeah. You're pretty much guaranteed. But I'm convinced I could get, seriously though, right? Mbappe, I would just go and get either one of the Ajax boys. I wouldn't go get, because I'm not on that boat. I would go and get Jota and probably just buy another Kyogo.
Yeah.
Because I know that Celtic are going to smash teams all season. I'm so bullish on Celtic, so I would probably just, I know we're back to Celtic again, I apologise. But I would, if I got Mbappe, I would sell him and I'd get in a Celtic stack, a proper, full-blown Celtic stack, and still have some change. You know, I couldn't keep him. I mean, it's quite a pleasant experience. I mean, is it a pleasant experience? Yeah, we're just constantly watching the team that, well, it's not any different to Celtic, is it? Because let's be honest, we're quite entitled fans, because we're, when you sit and speak to other fans in Scotland who are not, you know, Celtic or Rangers for that matter, like they don't have that experience, you know, it's all terrible stuff about, battered every week, or, you know, we're expecting to be in the top half.
Mind that time we get saved through administration?
Yeah, so all of that really horrible stuff that we certainly remember the bad old days of the mid-90s when, you know, Carol McGultons and John Burns were, and is it Andy Slater? Was it Andy? I can't remember his name. Yeah, exactly. I think that sums it up. I can't remember his name. So half of that team was like that, but, you know, I mean, yeah. Supporting Celtic is relatively easy, particularly in Scotland. So, I would go straight to Celtic. I don't think I would mess around with many of the top guys. I mean, even see Messi right now, right? As much, I mean, Messi's just a god of football. I don't think in my opinion, I'm wearing on the Queen's Jubilee my favourite football player ever, Diego Armando. But I would probably argue that Messi is the best player of all time. I mean, Maradona is my favourite player of all time. And I think for me, anyway, and I'm biased, obviously, Maradona would be in second place. But Messi is probably the best player I've ever seen. However, at this moment, if I had his card, I would be nervous.
Why would you be nervous? He gets injured or something?
That for sure, but there's something really odd about his current trajectory in his career.
I think he goes to America next. Do you know the latest rumor I heard was
Miami?
They're going to cut him in on owning the club.
What's happened to football now?
They'll cut him in on owning the club. They'll give him like 30% of the team. How quality is that if you're Messi?
I mean, if he goes to the MLS, there's that mental utility, but it's...
Mate, you think what Cicinha does? Imagine Messi.
Yeah. Okay, there's zero doubt. Yeah, he'll be smart. What? How old is Messi now?
34, I'm going to say.
Messi's birthday's like around about this time, if I remember rightly. Yeah, 24th of June. So he'll be 35 in like 3 weeks. I'm more nervous about him, I have to say. I think... I rate him as the best player of all time. I just feel like having grown up with a hat trick every week, Messi, that, you know, I just don't see that guy anymore. And I think in Paris, You've seen, I mean, if you're just purely SO5 scores, there's lots of, you know, 40s and stuff like that, that you're not getting in the likes of your Mbappes and Neymars, albeit I think Neymar's
got a horrible DNP record.
Yeah, and I think, is he not saying he's only going to play football another year or two or something as well?
Neymar? I wouldn't be surprised. That'd be so funny. It'd be so Neymar as well.
Yeah, he's not going to. He's not going
to. Wants to go hang out with Justin Bieber in Las Vegas.
What's that?
He wants to go hang out with Justin Bieber in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
Go do some TikTok videos and go to the MTV Music Awards.
see, the thing is, like, I always say, I know this is like a complete departure from just general conversations about football, but like people become so indoctrinated and bought into the idea and the model of football. And like, I remember, like, I think it was Dennis Law talking to Graham Taylor, and they were saying, oh, these modern days, and you know, football should be at 3 o'clock on a Saturday and stuff like that. And you're like, it's just like this ability for people to, you know, to adapt, to change, and you know, and understand,
modernize
that, you know, yeah, totally. Because could you imagine how boring football would be realistically now if all football was just 3 o'clock on a Saturday? I mean, I maybe it's quite selfish of me, but I just think that would be pretty boring. So the idea that, you know, there's all those kind of old school sentiments, but then there's just the other part, which is just there is a life outside of football, you know. And if you can imagine that you've given, I mean, if you could just imagine being Neymar, it's not just that you've given all of that time of your life to football, but it's just that you've given all that time to other people and all that part of your life just to football. And I mean, I don't, again, I'm my age Omar for players tonight is terrible, but I think, what is Neymar, like 30 now?
I think I'm going to guess about that, yeah.
Just going to double check, yeah. So he's 30 years old. I mean, that's still a great innings he'll have given football, you know? So yeah, I mean, if he went out at that age, I would say fair dues. I mean, he's not, he definitely hasn't fulfilled the potential, I don't think, to the guy that he could have been, because I think that a lot of people expected, well, certainly I didn't, I expected him to be the best in the world. That was the, I thought he was going to get to Messi, Ronaldo levels, and he just hasn't.
Just short, isn't he?
Yeah, he is just short. I mean, there's granted, those are superhuman levels that those two guys, you know, consistently hit for, like that good 10-year spell. I don't think he's consistent enough to ever be in that bracket. Whereas I think there's others. Just a question. Who's the best player in the world for you right now?
Right now. Great question. My kind of bias and my instinct tells me I should say De Bruyne, but best player in the world right now. Yeah, I think it maybe is De Bruyne, by the way. Maybe Haaland. Oh, Jesus. I don't know. It's not something I've actually given much thought to be quite honest with you. The best right now. My favourite is definitely De Bruyne in terms of like my favourite world-class player that's knocking around now. I think in terms of likelihood of winning a Ballon d'Or or whatever, it's probably going to be Benzema. And I don't know, beyond that, I guess, like, if I was to put it like this, like, I think, I'll answer your question by saying this, I'd probably say Sadio Mane in a weird about way, because I think, like, for all the plaudits that Liverpool, and it feels like Liverpool get way more plaudits for losing this season than Man City have done for winning, but, like, for all the plaudits that Liverpool get, and it's mainly laid on Salah, I think every football fan in the world has uttered the words, but I prefer Mane. At some point in their life, you know, whether it's talking about Liverpool, Salah, every football fan at some point has went, but there's something about Mane, or but I like Mane better, or he's just that, I think he's just got that something that, it's not necessarily talent in the sense that like he can do 12 step overs and rainbow flick somebody, but he does have something in his game that like every football fan like identifies with, and like I don't think anyone hates on him. I don't think he gets any abuse of any description at any time, you know.
And I agree with you, by the way. I think Manny's a better player than Salah. I really do. I actually mentioned this point before, where we talked about Salah having the biggest amount of big chances missed in the English Premier League. It was something like 25 or something like that. I just from watching him, obviously, it was a vested interest with Luis Diaz, and I always felt just doesn't pass the ball enough, too greedy, just a selfish player. Whereas I think Manny's an unselfish player, Diaz is an unselfish player, constantly looking to square the ball. Notwithstanding, he's clearly a freakishly world class player. Also,
yeah,
I just think I would pick Manny over him. Yeah. For sure. Just a bit, like you say, you know, a more likeable team player. But and I think as well with Liverpool, the latter part of that season, I don't know.
They played them too much.
Yeah, they're a great team. I think they just didn't have enough. I mean, I thought even in that final, they never looked like winning at any point. And I think in those big, big moments is when you need to turn up. You know, that's the difference, isn't it? That's why Liverpool won that game in Istanbul, because just great determination, decision making in those fine moments. People can say, oh, luck and whatever. No, that's just the difference at that top level. It's really, you know, tiny margins. And he just didn't have it this year. And I think Real Madrid demonstrated, you know, over the piece that they, as they'd done in all of those games and on the build-up to the final, you know, there was tiny margins. They just had that bit of quality, or, you know, mental strength, or, you know, just good decision-making. I think this will be the biggest test for Liverpool, actually, after, because I get a sense there's going to be a breaking up of that team. Maybe it'll be a good thing. I'm 50,
feels like they've been kind of preparing for it. It feels like Jota, Diaz, there have been kind of brought in as like heirs to the throne for some of those positions in that front definitely. Three, you know.
Yeah, I can
see they've done a bit of the legwork already. It's just whether they can gel together without having Salah and Mane next to them, or at least one of them, you know, or whatever the combination becomes.
I think Diaz is already, I mean, I know
feels
I've joked
like the, about, he feels like a best 11 player now, doesn't he?
I think Diaz is on the level of Salah already. I think he has another gear to go up as well. I think probably the one thing about Diaz that I would say is he should be a bit greedier. I mean, I said that all when I watched him at Porto as well. I said, see if he was, because they have that big strike. Yeah, the striker just annoyed me, because he was just totally, you know, like the amount of times where I needed a double decisive and he just squares the ball with Diaz for a tap in and he would just shoot and you were like, see you again. No, there's some. I think Diaz absolutely will, once he's allowed to be the main man, he'll take Liverpool to the same heights again, I think. Jota has been phenomenal for them. I mean, maybe that will free him up again. Like you say, I don't think Liverpool will be in huge trouble up front. You would imagine they'll strengthen it probably. I mean, I know that Darwin has been one of the players linked with Liverpool as well.
And everyone.
Yeah. I don't know. I think it's certainly the biggest test they'll have had under Klopp in terms of, you know, having to rebuild parts of the squad. I've seen, is Van Dijk leaving as well? Or is that just...
No way, is he?
No, I thought...
I've not heard that.
So if these players... if any of these players that are rumoured, Sané's already, is it Bayern he's going to?
Mané, it sounds like it. I don't know if anything's confirmed.
And Salah as well. So, you know, you've got definitely a rebuilding job in there. I think there's lots of those players, though, that, I mean, the likes of the Milners and the Hendersons, and not good enough for Liverpool, in my opinion. You know, like, you could... We talked about Callum McGregor. Callum McGregor is an infinitely better player than Jordan Henderson, for example, in my opinion. I think the guy gets... He's good. But, you know, I think if he was in English, he'd probably not be in that team. I think they've got better players kicking around there. Thiago's just... You can just tell Thiago's touch, just everything, you know, just phenomenal. I don't think Henderson's got any of that. I mean, Milner was
aging.
But yeah, I mean, obviously now, but I mean, Milner was all of that. He was, you know, absolutely phenomenal, but obviously he's not aged. Well, he's maybe, I mean, that's maybe even harsh actually, because to be fair, he's playing at elite level. So I think it's just quite simply elite levels caught up with him, you know, and he's not, his body's not able to keep up with that, but for sure, you know, he's had a great career. But Henderson is one that I've been struggling with for, you know, for some time at Liverpool. I just don't get it. I think maybe he's just great at shouting in the changing room. I mean, he's clearly an outstanding talent, but, not for me. Not for me.
Well, I've always been like that with him as well. It just feels like there's some players that get into some teams and it's 100% down to, like, you know, not to use an old cliche, but like they're a big character in the changing room, like you say. Like, and you know, it's, you know, when you're in these kind of environments, like I know from like just recently, like through coaching and stuff like that, but like there is some players that, like, if they are going to produce, and Henderson's kind of like this as well, I suppose, but a guy that can perform for you 6 out of 10 on the pitch, and it's such a cheesy thing to say, and I can't believe I'm going to say it, but if he can help other people play at 8 out of 10, then you can carry his 6 out of 10, if you know what I mean. Now, I'm not saying Jordan Henderson in particular.
Yeah.
Necessarily does that. Right. But like, sometimes, like, yeah, you take that guy out, and there's some of those guys you look at and you're like, how can him not be in there? The team gets so much worse. You know, because it's not as if he's doing something incredible that we're now missing, but it's just this it's a personality thing, I think. You know, men lead men sometimes, and it's like some people need led and some people want to be, you know, in terms of the football pitch, not everyone's a captain. Some guys are just players. They want to be told, that's your man, go and fucking get him, or, you know, whatever it might be. So I was kind of, those weird ones I can't get my head around, if it's particularly a midfielder, I would kind of normally chalk up to that kind of thing. But again, you're right, the whole English bias definitely comes into it, but the media and the homegrown status and everything. Like, if he was Welsh or Irish or something, he's playing for Hull, you know, like, that's the India.
Look, and it's a good point, like, in terms of, you know, that, I mean, you've played football, you've seen those players that are just really loud and galvanising and, you know, intimidating maybe other teams on the pitch, you know. There's definitely parts of that you don't see, you know, from the sidelines. And, you know, like Scott Brown at Celtic, particularly the latter part, you know, where he's galvanising teammates. But, I mean, realistically, all he's doing is passing the ball sideways in the middle of the pitch. You know, he's not actually giving a great... Yeah, he's not really, but so I absolutely agree with you. Like, in situations like that, is he getting better out of, is he getting the best out of other players whilst he's on the pitch? And absolutely, yes. And I think using him as an example of even during the Brendan Rodgers era at Celtic, you could see that Rodgers just got that as well. He was like, no, I need this guy to be my leader and my captain. So, I mean, I don't see enough of Henderson at Liverpool to say that for sure, but I kind of sense there's a bit of that as well. So, yeah, I mean, for sure, but I guess I'm just purely looking at him as a footballer. And
yeah.
And And I just
better players in that team that score more SO5 points.
Yeah, I mean, I actually think Liverpool have simply got better players there already. You know, like, I think it's just a case of. Do you know what part of the issue is, right? Like, if you look at, and this is like a plague of English football in general now, is that there's just not many English players like in that top league. You know, I went to see Celtic Man City, and it was the one that away at the Etihad. I think it was one each. It was anyway. I was in we were invited down. It was corporate hospitality stuff, and I was sitting in the main stand with all the Man City fans and neutral fans, but it was lots of Celtic fans who were in the hospitality. I think it must have been like, you know, a lot of companies went, right, oh, let's get the Glasgow offices down and wine and dine them. So anyway, there was a chant during, it was the second half, and all the Man City fans started shouting, England, 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 England. And I was looking on the pitch, and Man City did not have one player on the pitch that was English.
Oh, wow.
Celtic had three. I was just like, is that, surely that's been noticed by someone here? You know, definitely, like the total irony that you don't even have an English player on your pitch. And I think that, okay, England have got a good team now, but is it really that? I mean,
some of the forwards are epic. Another player that's got a great shout for best player in the world would be Son. You know, I've seen the day, like, he won, like, the Golden Boot or whatever he got. He scored zero penalties, is an interesting part of that, you know, which not many people win the Golden Boot without scoring a pen, you know.
How many goals did he score?
I can't remember.
Oh, was it not, like, joint with Salah, or did I just made that up?
He definitely won the Golden Boot, because when he landed in Korea, everyone was at the airport
to see it. Yeah, I've seen that video. Yeah, 23 he got, and Salah, how many did he get? Greedy boy.
Oh, I think he was one or two off it.
Was he? Ah, right. I thought he...
I think the last day of the season he did a hat-trick or something.
23 goals as well?
Oh, did he? Maybe it's assists that split it. Or maybe the penalty thing splits it.
Did they not just share it? Or is that not a thing?
I don't think they share it, no. It'll be split on assists or the penalty thing, I think. Maybe that's why I found that stat out. Maybe that's why relevant.
But yeah. Sorry, you were saying about Son.
But there's a great argument for him being, like technically speaking, maybe one of the best footballers in the world, you know, one of them. Even though he's playing for Tottenham and whatever, but like, if you watch Son, like, he is breathtaking as an individual. Like, you could put him in any team in the world and you're going to get 9 out of 10.
But you're going to say you're going to get 9 in a row? Maybe.
No. Yeah, it's been a couple of years before talking about that again.
See, there's one notable absence in your discussion for the World Player of the Year, and when that was the one that I would actually pick, which is Mbappe.
I've tried to leave out, like, so I was thinking, like, I can't say De Bruyne, and I was thinking, like, Haaland and Mbappe and Messi and all that, like, forget about them. I was just thinking about different people. But Mbappe as well, like, I think Mbappe is maybe, like, the best forward in the world, but, like, I'm not sure he's the best footballer in the world, you know, actual football player, like, the best at playing football.
I think he is. I think he's head and shoulders. I'm actually really passionate about Mbappe just now, because I think, you know, like, see the way I was, I mean, Messi's just on a fine, like, it's like that bit where Bilbo Baggins is going onto the little boat, and that's Messi at the moment, right? I think
do you know what's really funny? I need to say this before I forget, right? I was saying to you guys, when I can't remember what it was, but you started referencing Hunters of Star Wars in your podcast, and I just went through a spell of, like, curing a wee bit of insomnia by watching episode one. So, like, some of the stuff you were saying kept coming up. And see the Bilbo Baggins reference there? See, for the last month, I've been watching Lord of the Rings to fall asleep to.
Right.
So I'm
thinking I've been
you've got my Netflix account
So I think the thing we, like, you know, like we were talking about Neymar, where Neymar had that opportunity. I mean, because ultimately Neymar left Barcelona to be what Messi was at Barcelona.
Yeah. When he was at Barca, he was just on the cusp of Ballon d'Or. Everyone was like, oh, Neymar's so good. When Messi goes, he'll step up.
But there was no doubt. It was everyone was saying, everyone had the top two as Messi and Ronaldo, and the top three, in the third place was nailed on. There was no confusion. But the point for me was that didn't work. He went to PSG, and within a matter of time, you know, he was already overtaken by Mbappe. I think Mbappe winning that World Cup at such a young age and having such an active role and winning that propelled him to that level. I just feel that he's now the main man at PSG. There's zero doubt in my brain about that, and that's quite powerful for to be the main man and have two of the guys who have been in the top three players in the last 10, 15 years in world football, to be the centre figure in that is already quite powerful. And I never
thought about it like that.
If you look at the standard that we used to, you know, used, you know, for Messi and Ronaldo, it was like, oh, there's another hat-trick, you know, on the Saturday night Messi would score a hat-trick, on the Sunday Ronaldo would score one back. It was like,
yeah,
I mean, just brilliant days. I think you're seeing Mbappe at that level now. He's definitely getting to that level. I think in terms of who's in purely in terms of the season of 2021 to 2022, yeah, there's players in there that you could argue have had a better season, like Benzema, and you mentioned Son. There's loads of players for sure, but I just think in terms of if you put that guy in any team, who could be the one player that you could say for absolute certain would affect the game in it? For me, that's Mbappe. So I think he's personally, I mean, obviously we don't know what's going to happen the rest of the year, but personally, Mbappe's going to be, he's on path for the Ballon d'Or this year, I think.
Well, see, the thing about the World Cup, the Ballon d'Or, is it'll be before the World Cup,
Is it not? Is it not in December?
Aye, but the World Cup final's like 2 weeks later or something. I had this chat with my pal, and I said to him, "I'd be really interested." We were chatting about Ballon d'Or. I was like, "Well, when is the Ballon d'Or again? Because it's normally about Christmas time, and when's the final?" And he looked into it, and he's like, "Aye, the Ballon d'Or is meant to get done like 3 weeks before the World Cup final or something." Which is odd. Normally, obviously, the World Cup would be in the summer, and that would play a huge part on the winter Ballon d'Or in December, wouldn't it? You know, but
surely they'll change that. Surely they, with that in mind, they will. Because if they're
stubborn enough to not give it to Lewandowski and cancel it because of COVID, I don't know. I can see them being pretty rigid and just going, "No, this is the day we do the Ballon d'Or." Then fuck you, we're doing it.
Yeah, but what did you think of when? I mean, I thought Modric winning the Ballon d'Or was the biggest piece of nonsense ever.
It felt like a lifetime achievement award more than a Ballon d'Or.
That's the best summary of it.
Yeah, Croatia final, Champions League, so it was all good, but it was class, you know. But
do you know when I was I remember one time when I was playing football when I was younger, and we won a tournament, and we beat the team who was expected to win the tournament, and it was Morton, actually. It was the team that we beat, and I think they were like the strongest team in the tournament, and everyone expected them to win it, and we beat them anyway. I remember they had the prize for the player of the tournament, and I heard the guy who was giving the prize say to our manager, "What's your captain's name?" So basically, the way they decide, because he clearly didn't expect us to win it, didn't know our players, And he just asked the manager what's the captain's name and just went, there you go, the winner, Stephen Docherty. And I just felt, I was like, really? He's just won that because he's the captain? And I think there's that kind of token type gesture part that I feel like, I mean, your summary of it being the Lifetime Achievement Award is actually, I couldn't have put it any better. It's actually exactly what it was.
I think it'll be that with Benzema when he gets his as well. But he's been class as well, of course.
I don't think you can argue with Benzema. I mean, I think you can argue all you like, but that's a Ballon d'Or. I think Benzema getting it, I wouldn't begrudge him. I think Benzema's had, what's that? 15 Champions League goals in 12 games this season. I mean, that's mental.
Yeah.
I mean, that is Messi levels.
That's winning the team the tournament, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I certainly think that winning that player of the tournament was less of a tone gesture. 27 goals. So he's one goal behind Mbappe. But, I mean, wasn't really any competition in France, was there? Like, realistically.
Monaco were terrible. Lille were terrible. Marseille were kind of up and down, but aye, there's not much.
Kind of blew. I mean, there was the gap in the top there was so massive. So yeah, I think, yeah, I wouldn't begrudge. Benzema's probably one of the only players that I would say, yeah, fair dues. If he, you know, finishes, 40 goals in the season, fair enough. He would definitely, I mean, that's probably one of the best seasons he's had.
I think it's his best season.
Yeah.
He's like a wine Benzema.
A what?
He's like a fine wine.
Totally. Do you remember there was a documentary about him? I remember it was a while. Remember he was properly out of favour and he was accused of all this different stuff. And but I've always liked him. Like always liked him. I think it's probably because I remember those days when he was like, it was like that explosive young Benzema. I remember when he was at Lyon.
He scored hat-tricks against Rangers, you mean?
Yeah, I mean, those are the good old days. That was I think you see, it's like you say, like a fine wine, but I think that's just, that's that, I mean, I think, how long can he keep that up for? Because again, he's what, 34? So you, I mean, it's quite mental for him actually, at that age, that level.
Yeah.
Because what's Ronaldo now? Is he, Ronaldo's a good bit older now, isn't he? He's like
37 going on 38, I think.
Really?
Something like that.
Is he
definitely
that?
In the 37 range? Like,
yeah,
he's either there or just getting to it.
37. You're right. I mean, that's, what is he going to, is that just, I mean,
he's staying for next year. Ten Hag is looking forward to working with him, and I think he's going to be part of the Seb Haller, I think, in this Man United team. They're just going to put him in the final 18 yards and feed him like mad, which is probably what you should be doing all along with him, you know.
Yeah,
if you can defend, you can get away with it. You know, it's been an absolute pleasure, but I'm going to cut the video here because there's definitely no chance anyone else is going to be still watching this. Mark, if you want to hear more from Mark, he is one of the hosts of the Sorare Odyssey. That is available in all the podcast places. It will be linked in the description down below. Mark, it's been an absolute pleasure, my man. Thanks a lot for coming on.
Appreciate it. Good to speak to you as always, and I'll catch you again, man.